Good evening. It is now 5:11 on May 4th, 2022. A call to order this administrative public hearing, which is being held pursuant to section 255.1A of the Municipalities Financial Recovery Act, also known as Act 47. The sole purpose of this hearing is to receive evidence and testimony regarding the potential termination of Reading's status as a financially distressed municipality. We cannot respond to any questions or challenges at this hearing. My name is Andrew Schief, Local Government Policy Manager for the Department of Community and Economic Development, and I will be serving as the hearing officer today. For the record, this hearing was advertised in the Reading Eagle on April 27th, 2022, and written notice was provided to the city clerk, mayor, solicitor, council members, controller, and acting city manager prior to the meeting. As background for the members of the public with us today, on April 11th, 2022, the recovery coordinator for the City of Reading, PFM Group Consulting, LLC, submitted a final report in accordance with Section 255 of Act 47. The coordinator's report reviewed the City of Reading's financial condition in conjunction with statutory factors listed in Section 255.1A of Act 47, and concluded that the City of Reading's status as a distressed municipality should be terminated. Per Section 255.1A of Act 47, the department is required to hold a public hearing within 30 days of receiving the final coordinator's report. Once again, the sole purpose of this hearing is to receive evidence and testimony regarding the potential termination of Reading's status as a financially distressed municipality. Individuals representing Reading, Reading's Act 47 coordinator, and the Governor's Center for Local Government Services will be presenting evidence and testimony tonight. After the department has received evidence and testimony from the previously mentioned parties, I will invite any other interested party in the audience to provide evidence and testimony. Please note, there is a sign-in sheet that has been circulated to verify attendance at the hearing today. I will ask that all in attendance please sign the sheet, even if you are not providing evidence or testimony. If you change your mind later and do decide you want to provide testimony, please know that all witnesses will be required to be sworn in by the stenographer prior to testifying. At this time, I call Mayor Eddie Moran, City of Reading, to the witness stand. That's fine. Just we'll have the stenographer swear everybody in before we start.
Everybody, when you testify, please raise your right hand. Thank you very much. Will you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth that matters set before you? Do you say I do?
I do.
Witnesses at home, please sworn.
Thank you. Please begin.
Good afternoon. And welcome to the City of Reading. My name is Eddie Moran, and I serve as the mayor of this great city of Reading. I would like to first welcome you and also thank you for joining us today in our great city council chambers. Isn't this place beautiful, right? It is very nice to host visitors once again as we move beyond COVID-19. In fact, just a few days ago, we had the great privilege to host Acting Secretary of DECD, Mr. Neil Weaver, on a visit to Reading, kicking off Small Business Week here in the Commonwealth. We did a mobile and walking tour of a cross-section of new and long-term small businesses that have found ways to open, survive, and thrive, despite the many challenges in many years. Some of them included La Casa de Chimney and the Juice Bar, New Heights Grocery, and the Great American Creamery. Getting hungry again, just saying those names. We close out the visit at the American Barber and Beauty Academy, the first of its kind located right here in the city of Reading. But back to the reason why we are here to visit today. This public hearing on our exit from Act 47 and the end of the label of a financial distress. I want to take a moment to single out and thank Gordon Mann from PFM, our recovery coordinator for the last decade plus. He and his team have worked tirelessly to help us stabilize our finances and reframe our work thinking forward bigger and brighter prospects and opportunities for our city. I know he cares deeply about our progress, and we appreciate it. Sir, thank you. I have been honored to serve as the city's mayor since January 6, 2020, a day that is remembered for some unfortunate events in Washington. As those events occur in Washington, my team came into office ready to work and make a difference. Even as a global pandemic, the likes of which many and most of us had not seen nor experienced before, began to hold of our city, state, and nation. Reading, designated a financial distress municipality, had overcome years of financial challenges. I quickly learned everything I cannot do due to the restrictions under Act 47. And I say that jokingly, but however, is a reality when you're a common citizen and don't see those things. With now 2 years under my administration, I have been able to fully understand the very necessary recommendations and parameters set by the Act 47 and appreciate the effectiveness of these provisions. Many of them were in the area of labor relations, negotiating terms related to our bargaining agreements, and strict controls surrounding our health insurance costs and contributions. The ability to levy the commuter tax was also essential, as it gave us the ability to fund capital improvement and defer maintenance responsibilities in a generation or more. While on this topic, I would like to take a moment to acknowledge our city council president, whom I know would have loved to be here today, but unfortunately is unable to be with us due to health issues, which we keep him lifted in prayer. However, President Councilman Waltman would put me in a headlock if I did not put in a formal request to allow the city of Reading to retain the commuter tax, even after exiting Act 47. While we recognize that this will take an act of the legislation, we still implore you to lobby for it on our behalf. Please let the record reflect a formal request to retain the commuter tax, that it has been very helpful to both the community and the communities alike. It has helped us support and provide many of our newly paved streets that include ADA curbs, ramps, to those that come into the city to work or live here. It has supported our excellent public safety teams of police, fire, and EMS service. Let us also not forget the vigilant street sweeping and cleaning from public works. And there is so much more that still needs to be done, built and fixed. It would be significant for us to retain that revenue to contain and continue making progress on many capital projects that directly benefits the community. Reading has been labeled as distressed under Act 47 program since 2010. As we come out of a global pandemic in 2022, with a stable balance sheet, a healthy fund balance reserve that far exceeds 20% of our general fund budget, no deficits within the last 5 years or more, newfound traction luring development projects to the city, and executing our own capital improvement, I firmly believe that now more than ever, our city is ready to exit Act 47 with limitless opportunities for success ahead of us. Distress is a thing of the past, folks. 3 years ago, the city adopted an exit plan that our Act 47 coordinator recommended to the Secretary of the Department of Community and Economic Development to take back the order declaring the city of Reading financially distressed. Following current law, and the secretary should consider 4 specific factors in making that determination. My finance director, Mr. Jamal Kelly, will walk you through those factors, but rest assured, we check those boxes and much more. For all of his advantages, and there are many, I've mentioned tonight and those I have yet to, or else we'll be here well into the night, I can assure you. It should also be noted that there are also some limitations to Act 47 program. Aside from creating a significant new revenue stream and then taking it away, navigating a pandemic that shut down businesses and offices with the requirement of providing municipal services at the same time, if not a higher level, due to the mandates from the governor, Department of Health, and CDC recommendation was not easy, folks. It does not address the significant increase in unemployment and then rebound that still finds people shifting careers or leaving the workforce across all industries, sectors, both public and private. It doesn't address disagreements between a mayor and council members, be they small, unyielding. However, Act 47 program and our coordinator have forced us to look at the bigger picture issues and craft new policy procedures around them that are sustainable beyond political headwinds and almost predictable turnovers as people grow and desire to pursue other passion. This process has also helped us prioritize hiring qualified personnel and consulting support where appropriate to implement the coordinator and plan recommended cost controls and project implementations. Whether it is working to complete the consent decree for the water, wastewater treatment plan administration and operations, or acting on a long dormant CIP capital improvement plan, which finally has the 9th and Marion fire station well under construction with a planned December dedication ceremony for the new facility, something that was advocated by a council member, former council member, for almost 15 years. We are also going to finally fix a roof here in City Hall, things that have been talked about for years, if not decades, are finally being accomplished here in the city of Reading. And it is a credit to our diligent, hardworking employees and the expertise of our partners at PFM and DCED. We appreciate you more than you know. Thank you from the bottom of our heart. I speak on behalf of the citizens of Reading. As I close, let me assure you that we, as an administration and council body, remain sober-minded about the challenges ahead after Act 47, while also very optimistic that we will not need to call on you in the near or distant future. For this program, at least, we thank you for your support over the 12 past years. We also declare we are ready to exit and stand on our own feet. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony. I call Johanny Sepeda Freitas, Council Vice President, City of Reading.
Good evening, and thank you for this opportunity and for this hearing and for allowing us all to speak and give our input. Unfortunately, Jeff Waltman, Council President Jeff Waltman, is not with us. So as the mayor stated, you know, we ask that everyone continues to keep him in prayer for his speedy recovery. So on his behalf and on council behalf, the city has reached a pivotal point in time as the DCED prepares to consider removing Reading from the Act 47 program. First, I have to thank the DCED for assigning PFM to guide us through this difficult 13-year process, and especially thanking Gordon Mann for all the difficult work he did to teach us and at times give us some tough love when we were poised to make bad decisions. Gordon is excellent at his job, and we will all miss having his help and guidance. While we are all relieved that Reading has reached this point in time, some who have watched the city progress over these 13 years are concerned that this and future administrations have not retained the valuable lessons the Act 47 process has taught us, as we are starting to see questionable spending decisions and practices since under the exit plan, Mr. McMahon has less authority and control over our decisions. While the city seems to have a wealthy fund balance, one large miscue can change that in a flash. The programs available to municipalities while they're in the Act 47 program help to stabilize the municipality financially, but outside of Act 47, those programs are stripped away. As Council President Jeff Waltman has repeatedly said, if municipalities need those programs while in Act 47, how can they survive without them after Act 47? And Jeff is absolutely right. Our decade of requests to the state legislators to retain the commuter tax after Act 47 and for amendments to the Act 511 tax statute enacted in the 1960s have fallen on deaf ears. And repackaging of the commuter tax as the payroll tax is going nowhere, as none of the state legislators have signed on as sponsors. Fortunately, Mr. Mann made us shift the commuter tax revenue from the operating budget to the capital budget. And for the first time in two decades, the city finally has capital funding, which will shrink away after July 14, 2022, and leave us where we started pre-Act 47, with the need to repair aging infrastructure with no funding. While we are pleased to shed this Act 47 distressed designation, we're also cautious. So as City Council continues to work with this and future administrations to make sound financial decisions that will retain the city's financial well-being, we ask you at the DECD to work with the state legislators to help municipalities, especially third-class cities, to amend the antiquated Act 511 tax statute and consider other legislative changes that will provide municipalities with an increased level of flexibility with various revenue generating options. Thank you so much for your time. And I will pass it on, I think, to Councilwoman Marsha, who would like to add a few more words on behalf of council.
Thank you for your testimony.
Good evening, and it is such an honor to be part of this process today. I remember years ago sitting at my council seat when the action was taken to move us into Act 47. That was a painful process, but it was a reality test. When I first joined City Council, I was not aware of the burden that we were going to take on, the financial condition of the city. It was astounding to me that a city could function in that condition and survive. And certainly, as I was elected to my second term and we moved into Act 47, it was clear that we had no capacity. But thank goodness that the state had the option of Act 47 to help us through the distress. Just to set a little background on this, before we moved into Act 47, there was substantial efforts taken by citizens, including our council president, Jeff Waltman. Before he joined council, he was involved in financial oversight of the city. So there were a lot of experienced people looking at city finances. So when we came to the realization that we weren't going to move forward without being declared a distressed city, we knew that we needed to be able to not deny where we were, to accept the reality and to move on. I think the greatest gift that we received as a city was the services of DECD and PFM, because without their diligence and holding our feet to the fire, we would have never be where we are today. And I look at that as the fact that a lot of the solutions, as I sat through my first term of office, we weren't coming up with those solutions. And I'll give you some examples. Because we could not pay for certain things that we were in debt, we took out a police pension bond. Bad move, okay? But again, the advice that council was getting from its managing director at that point did not help us with that decision-making. It was also hard for me. And I have to say, my first year on council, I in no way was an expert at finances. I learned and grew through this. I'm now chair of the Finance Committee. I have been for several years. And I think that the growing process and the work that PFM did helped us all grow as council to be able to make those tough decisions. And so I really believe we have grown as a body, but in order to take on the challenges of moving Act 47, we need to have a reality check. It's not going to be just that we're not distressed anymore. We still have a challenge that our revenue is not sufficient to support the beautiful services and the critical services that the city needs. And an example, during Act 47, we were limited on the amount of personnel we could hire. Our police force was and still is severely undermanned, as is all of our other departments. Okay, so we were not at the point that we could support that. To look at what we really need to be able to run the city effectively, we're not quite sure where that revenue is going to come from moving forward. And that has to do with our tax base, the revenues that we can generate. So a lot of this is not easy. It's going to really take our hard work, working with the administration, council working together, being diligent about what we need to do as far as expenditures go. It's in no way going to be an easy street. And we're not the only city in this condition. I think it speaks to the nature of what's happening across the state and across the nation. The only difference is we're not like the federal government. We can't be trillions of dollars in debt. We have to keep a balanced budget. So we do that in the best way that we can. So I just wanted to point out some of the things that we did that I think were beneficial, and PFM gave us the guidance. When we looked at combining our pension funds, very sound advice, be able to maximize how we were going to be able to utilize our pensions. When we set up a policy for our fund balance, again, important, because we didn't have that policy before. You need a healthy fund balance to maintain the financial stability of the city. The use of the commuter tax for capital expenses. When I was navigating this through council, there were many years that we didn't even have a capital budget. Even though we saw the city falling apart with some of its capital needs, there was no money designated for that. Now we're finally at the point, and I thank this administration for being so proactive and making sure those major capital needs are being addressed. The downside to that is Act 47 allows us certain things that won't exist once we're no longer distressed. It won't allow the commuter tax, okay? And I can tell you, I work with colleagues that commute into the city. They would not mind paying the commuter tax, okay? They are willing to do that, but unfortunately, it takes state legislation to make that happen, and we haven't had any positive movement in that direction. Because of that, looking at the loss of the commuter tax in itself, there will be a certain point that we're not going to be able to continue to address our capital needs. The other piece that we need to look at is the protection as far as negotiating with the bargaining units. I don't want to take anything away from what all of our bargaining units bring to the city, but it has helped us not having to go into binding arbitration, which doesn't consider the financial condition of the city when decisions are made regarding contracts. So we need to look at a better way to navigate through that. Another item which I'm hoping the Department of Justice will look at is our ability to draw down from the sewage fund, which we're limited at this point, but we really do need to look at getting permission, and that would, again, help our budget. But beware, we have to be diligent about that. In the past, the city did not handle that appropriately, and that's why the Department of Justice said no to what we're doing. So there's been a lot of bad practices, and I wish someone would put together an encyclopedia of the things that maybe weren't done correctly so that we can look at those. And as we make our decisions, say, are we making the same mistakes again? Okay, and I don't know who might be able to help us with that, but I think we really need to be able to look at, these were where you turned in the wrong direction. This is how you stay on course. And for that, I would like to be able to ask, and I know it's being considered, that there is some way that PFM can stay in a consultant role with us to be able to guide us through our phase of exiting Act 47. If it's not PFM, another organization with the same capacity. You can't be able to put someone out that's learning to ride a bike and take off the training wheels and not expect them to fall. So we need someone to sort of be our training wheels as we move out of this process. And I know with my knowledge being chair of finance, how complicated it is and how difficult it might be to be able to make those decisions. The one thing about council that is extremely challenging is we're part-time, and we're responsible for making the major financial decisions about the city at a time that requires a lot of study of complicated financial documents. And it's something that requires a lot of training and insight, and not to take away with a lot of people bringing a lot of expertise and concern for the city, but we really all need to be on the same page to understand the consequences of our decision and where it's going to drive us down. A couple of things I just wanted to add that can happen we cannot lose our assets in order to remain fiscally solvent. We have a water system that is beyond none. We know that there are private vendors that would like to be able to take control of that. We cannot allow that to happen. We need to maximize the use of our sewage system, which serves the entire county, and be able to look at how we can be more regionalized in our approaches. Those are just some of my thoughts, but I think together as council, as the administration, and with our citizens, we need to come out with some practical ways of not just saying we're no longer distressed, but how do we stay in a situation that we will continue to have financial stability. This is a very precarious, fragile point that we're at now. And I just want to be reiterating from my point of view, I know that unless we continue to be diligent and mindful about every step that we take, every ordinance that we pass, every financial transaction that we do, there could be problems looming in the future. But we have a beautiful city, we cherish it. Just being in this council chambers is inspiring to me because it speaks to the history of the city, where we came from. We want to preserve that history, we want to preserve that legacy. And in order to do that, we need the support and tools. So thank you, and I'm honored to serve.
Thank you for your testimony. I call Jamar Kelly, Director of Administrative Services, City of Reading, to the witness stand.
Thank you. Thank you, Andrew. The voters eliminated the Department of Administrative Services in 2021. So I'm now just the finance director here at the city. But thank you for the opportunity to speak and provide testimony today on behalf of the city's more than 500 employees and staff. My name is Jamar Kelly, and I'm the finance director for the city of Reading. As Andrew mentioned, formerly the administrative services director. I've served in this role since March of 2019. And sometime prior to that, I had the pleasure to work with Reading in my capacity with the Commonwealth as a policy specialist. To that end, let me welcome and thank the Department of Community and Economic Development, specifically Rick Vallelo, Deputy Secretary, Kim Bracey, Head of the Governor's Center for Local Government Services, Andrew, my former boss, Fred Chapman, who's been with the city as a policy specialist for a long time as well, and all of the other great staff over the years that have helped Reading get to this exit hearing today. Next, I must thank, although a simple thanks doesn't quite do him justice, the immeasurable amount of advice and policy guidance that Gordon Mann, Ashley Anyu, Meredith Brett, and others at PFM have provided to us over the years that have been absolutely critical to the successful implementation of the recovery plan, the amended recovery plan, and the exit plans. Lastly, our city employees, both current and former, must be thanked and appreciated for both the sacrifice and resilience demonstrated over the 12 years in the Exit 47 program. We've made it through significant staffing and benefit reductions, wage freezes, a federal consent decree, a global pandemic, among many other challenges. The city of Reading has made huge strides in recent years since it was placed in the Municipal Financial Recovery Program, also known as Act 47. The city has produced balanced on-time budgets that have achieved surpluses in each of the last 6 years plus, save for some inter-fund transfers. Early on in Act 47, the commuter tax helped provide much needed additional revenue to the general fund. But since the amended recovery plan of 2014, we have weaned the general fund off of dependence of those additional revenues and dedicated that funding to capital improvements. That allowed us to build up a significant reserve of capital improvement funding over the years. We are now spending those reserves with verve, Gordon, and positioning ourselves to secure new revenue enhancements that will sustain our progress as we stand to lose the commuter tax revenue now with our exit from Act 47. With the coming implementation of a debt management policy, thanks to PFM and Mike Vind, our financial advisor, the city will be better positioned to entertain a new conversation about a variety of funding options as we look to remedy scores of deferred maintenance issues in our buildings, as well as other improvements, but also look to build out new facilities to accommodate the provision of government services that we are charged with. The mayor alluded to the four technical provisions that must be considered before a municipality can exit Act 47. Please allow me to elaborate further. When determining whether the city's distressed status shall be terminated, Section 255.1 on that Andrew mentioned of Act 47 requires the Secretary of DECD to consider the following four factors. One, operational deficits have been eliminated as evidenced by audited financial statements prepared in accordance with generally accepted accounting principles, and projections of future revenues and expenditures demonstrate a reasonable probability of future balanced budgets absent participation in Act 47. Thanks to the work of our finance staff and auditors, we have produced clean audits with less findings. When I started, we had 8 findings in the 2018 audit. In August of 2019, we hired a new city controller. There's now, we now have timely filing of all reports to state agencies. We have the production of our schedule of expenditure of federal awards without any issue. We are caught up on all of our indirect cost allocation reports, which determines the level of federal funding for overhead costs. And our 2020 audit completed last fall had only one finding. Number two, obligations issued to finance the municipality's debt have been retired, reduced, or reissued. The city has not issued any new debt for quite some time, and we have refinanced or reissued existing debt twice under my leadership, both in 2019 when terms were favorable, and then during late 2020 when it looked like we would have huge revenue losses as a result of the pandemic shutdowns. Just a little newsflash. It's sometimes overlooked, but we did not experience the drastic losses that were projected for 2020. In fact, we cut operational costs by 15% in both 2020 and 2021. Number three, all claims or judgments that would have placed the city in imminent jeopardy of financial default have been negotiated and resolved. As advised by our solicitor, since the adoption of the 2019 exit plan, the city has settled several lawsuits and has several lawsuits which are active or ongoing. While the city is involved in a fairly significant amount of legal actions, many of them are relatively small in value in terms of the city's overall financial outlook. The following is a summary of the more substantial ongoing and settled legal claims during the exit plan period. In 2021, the city resolved a class action lawsuit which challenged the city's fee for the collection of recyclables. Under the terms of the settlement agreement, the city paid plaintiffs attorney fees and costs totaling $259,000 and agreed to a court order which will limit the amount the city can charge for collection of recyclables to $69.40 per unit in 2022, $80 per unit in 23, and $85 per unit in 2024, rounding out with $90 per unit in 2025 and $95 per unit in 2026. In 2020, the city settled a wrongful termination case for $125,000. The city is in a process of completing settlement in a catastrophic slip and fall case in which the city tendered the $500,000 statutory limitation, and the city settled a case involving a civil rights violation prior to the filing of suit for $165,000. Number four, the city is projected to have positive operating balances for the first 5 years after the termination of distressed status. Projections of revenues shall include any anticipated tax or fee increases to fund ongoing expenditures for the first 5 years after termination of distress. We do project to have continued positive operating balances for the first 5 years after distress status termination. This projection is based both on recent past performance, fiscal prudence exercised by the administration and council members, as well as a significant windfall from the federal government through the American Rescue Plan Act that will send $61,134,970 into city coffers, the first half of which was received in March of 2021. The administration and council plan to invest a significant portion of this funding into a combination of economic development projects capital infrastructure projects, and revenue replacement that reduces any potential need for property tax increases in the first few years after Act 47. And I'm sure Gordon will go into a more detailed review of the numbers relative to those projections. Act 47 states that distressed status shall be rescinded, quote, if the secretary concludes that substantial evidence supports an affirmative determination for each of the prior four factors that I just walked you through. Substantial evidence is defined as such relevant evidence as a reasonable mind might accept as adequate to support a conclusion. Andrew, I leave it to your considered expertise along with the secretary to determine what, quote, a reasonable mind might accept as adequate. But certainly we believe that we've done our level best to do right by the city, especially through implementation of the aforementioned recovery through exit plans that have brought us to this hearing here today. To Marcia's point, so long as we continue to follow the plans that have created the path laid before us, including responsible contract negotiations, invigorated efforts to fill our vacant positions, and produce revenue enhancements that sustain our capital improvement budget through expansion of our tax base, negotiation of our upcoming lease agreements, water, sewer, similar to what we've recently done with the Reading Parking Authority, which was a long-term recommendation through both the amended plan and the exit plan that the Moran administration was able to execute last year with the Parking Authority that has produced $1.7 million in revenue, which hasn't happened since who knows how long ago. I believe the Spencer administration. I firmly believe Reading is in the best position it'll ever be to exit Act 47, thrive on its own, and continue to be able to provide the quality municipal services that are expected of us by our residents, constituents, commuters, and all of our stakeholders, both internal and external. We would not have gotten here without you, and we hope you'll continue to stick with us for many years to come. Thank you for your time.
Thank you for your testimony. I now call Gordon Mann, Recovery Coordinator, PFM Group Consulting.
Is this okay?
Yep, please begin.
Well, I guess the nice thing about going last is you have a lot less to say. So much has been said already. Let me go off script here a little bit and first say thank you to all of the folks here that we've had a chance to work with. Linda and Jamar and Marcia and Donna and Frank Heidig in the back there. A lot of folks who we've been through a very long process together, and it's been an honor. And as I've told you once before, it's been my greatest professional honor to work with you, and I just want to thank you for giving me that opportunity. Now, with the mushy stuff out of the way, let's talk a little bit of finances. Jamar did cover the four areas, the four criteria for the city to exit Act 47. I will leave it to you to decide whether I'm a reasonable mind or not, but I believe the city has met those criteria. And I'm not going to, Jamar's adequately covered all four of them. And if you want even more on that, there's the written report, but I did want to touch a little bit on the fourth criteria, which is the reasonable projection that the city's revenues and expenses will basically be in balance, right? This is the very appropriate question that the state wants to answer on your way out of F-47 is you're not coming back, right? we want to make sure that you're on stable footing and can stay out. And I agree with a lot of the comments that have been made here. I agree with the comments about the commuter tax, with the comments about the importance of reasonable and reasoned collective bargaining. I would say the unions, the Fraternal Order of Police and the IFF especially, deserve credit for some of what's happened here. They have shown an ability to look at what their proposals cost and come up with reasonable estimates of them. Now, they've had to do so because that's what the law requires, but they've demonstrated that technical capacity, and the city has as well. And that gives me, perhaps somewhat naively, but optimistically, some hope that that will continue, because the next round of negotiations will be very different. Act 47, this will be the first round of negotiations that the city goes through without the protections that Act 47 has provided in over a decade, and that is meaningful. The revenues and expenses, if you look at the projection and the baseline projection, which we've done many times, where you say if you do nothing, Councilor Waltman would jump in here and say that's not going to happen, and he would be right. The city's not going to not do anything. But if you do nothing, the revenues naturally grow more slowly than the expenditures do, right? That's not unique to Reading. It's not unique to cities of its size. That's not even unique to townships, counties, school districts, or even the Commonwealth itself. That's just the status quo. Doesn't mean it can and shouldn't be fixed, but Reading doesn't find itself in an unusual position there. If you're at home and you're listening and you're saying, well, why wouldn't the finances balance? Because the needs are higher than the resources. And that's generally true in everywhere, including in people's own personal checkbooks. So you have to manage both. And the city has demonstrated the ability to do that. Why do I think the city will be able to get out of Act 47? And why do they check that last box, that reasonable projection that revenues and expenditures will stay in balance? Well, two reasons. The first is that they've done it significantly and repeatedly over time. And I will consult my notes on this one because these numbers I have no chance of memorizing. But in 2018, the baseline projection, which again is intended to say, this is what happens if you do nothing. It's not a prediction of what will actually happen. Had a $13.1 million deficit. City had a surplus and put money aside for debt. 2019 baseline projection was a $15 million deficit. City had a $1.1 million surplus. 2020 was a $3 million deficit. That projection was before the pandemic. We probably would have went larger than that, and I think we probably did. The city's actual result was a $2.4 million surplus. 2021, $3 million deficit projection. I had the audits in process. I wouldn't be surprised if that shows a surplus too. So the best way you know that a city has the ability to balance its revenues and expenses is they show you that they can do it. And Reading has shown that they can do it. That said, progress is not inevitable. It's not guaranteed. It's not forever. There is continued work to do here. If you are a resident and you're saying, that's all great, but my street's not paved, and I want to see more cops in my neighborhood, and I'm worried about my taxes, you're right to have those concerns. This is not mission accomplished. There's no banner over my head. But this is that there is the next round of work is ready to be done outside of Act 47. In closing, I want to go back to a very cold, gray January day in 2010 when I was sitting in an office not too far from here with just, I think, Linda and Jeff Waltman and a number of folks from DECD. And after Jeff told us at length what he thought of a number of things, the way he closed the meeting is he said, you know, Reading is a hidden gem. If you just polish us and give us a chance to shine, we will. Reading's ready to shine outside of Act 47. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony. My next call, Frederick Chapman, Local Government Policy Specialist, Department of Community and Economic Development, to the witness stand.
Good evening, everyone. Mayor, Council, it's great to see you. In November 2009, the Pennsylvania Department of Community and Economic Development designated the city of Reading as financially distressed after amending and extending the city's original recovery plan. The city is at last financially stable. The city of Reading, Pennsylvania has sacrificed and worked extremely hard to see this day become a reality. The city cooperated and worked collaboratively with the Act 47 recovery team and DECD to satisfy much needed recommendations. The Commonwealth of Pennsylvania, specifically the State Department of Community and Economic Development, is extremely proud of the city's accomplishments. DECD has supported the city of Reading throughout the entire process, and we are extremely honored to share in the success of the city's road toward financial solvency. In addition to Act 47 funding, the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania supported the city with multiple financial funding program opportunities to assist in improving community development and basic quality of life. Several great funding programs, such as the Keystone Community, Blight Remediation, Multimobile Transportation, Greenways, Trails and Recreation, and the former Early Intervention Program, now known as STAMP, Strategic Management Planning Program. The administration had to face tough and sometimes unpopular decisions, but managed to make a remarkable turnaround in its financial performance since entering Act 47. Finally, DECD will continue to support the City of Reading just as we do all municipalities throughout the great Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. Serving as the DECD Local Government Southeast Regional Policy Specialist, I personally would like to congratulate this administration, and I agree with the Act 47 coordinator's recommendation for rescission status. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony. I would now like to invite any other interested party in the audience who would like to present testimony to please come up to be sworn in by the stenographer.
This would be public comment.
Hello, City Council, Government. My name is Carol Riley. I'm one of the people in here. Can you hear now? Okay. I've been living in the city since 2011. I've seen a building. I've had my eyes on a lot of buildings, and I've been in them already. And what bothers me more than anything is we need to get things active in this community, not just for kids, but any age bracket, even the veterans, the seniors. I've had a lot of people touch base with me in the past years. They say, I have nowhere to go. What can we do to keep ourselves busy? Because we're always bored. I try to keep them occupied any way, shape, or form I can. I've been in the building between Chestnut and Sixth Street, okay? That's been blocked. Number one, how in God's name is somebody supposed to get on the walkway without getting hit? And not just that, a lot of the lights, I should be with public, with codes or whatever, but with lights, the situation is, what? Okay, I'm sorry about that. Let me back up. Sorry about that. With the buildings and everything, we definitely have to look into that. Mayor Moran, I would greatly appreciate doing it with you as well as City Council, because inside some of these buildings, they're history. I went into one of them. There's three old things in there. So why can't we bring history back into life into the city? Like this young gentleman said, it was a charm or something like that. If it is, we need to get it active. So I appreciate very much. I thank you again.
Thank God bless. You. And respectfully, I'll be more than happy to have you come into our office and chat with us at length, okay?
Yes, I thank you. God bless.
Thank you for your testimony.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Maria Rodriguez, and I became the city auditor in 2019 when council appointed me to become city auditor, and then I was elected in 2020. Working with this administration and city council has been we have faced a lot of challenges, but by the same token, we all look for the same to make the city better for everybody, for our residents, for us, because we are part of our city. I want to say thank you to Mr. Gordon. Anytime that I have questions, and I ask him, send him an email and ask him for detail and stuff like that. We had a great working professional relationship also with the administration. I want to say thank you tonight, and we are looking for the best to have a better city here at the City of Reading and trying to do our best. So it's a pleasure to be part of the exit at 47. We have worked all together to make this possible. So thank you, everyone.
Thank you for your testimony. Seeing no other witnesses, I would like to take this opportunity to thank those in attendance and those who provided evidence and testimony at today's administrative public hearing. Today's evidence and testimony will be presented to Acting Secretary Neil Weaver for his final determination as to whether Reading's status as a financially distressed municipality should be terminated. Pursuant to Section 255.1B of Act 47, the determination will be issued within 90 days of today's hearing. Thank you. This hearing will now be adjourned at 6:01.